happy to say that somehow this day was useful, not only in terms of winning more prestige, but also in terms of making some research. And actually, the lectures that I gave last time, and so now it has nothing to do with supersymmetry, but nevertheless, it turned out that in principle, some new ideas for quantum criticality for systems, to be more specific, for two-dimensional quantum critical systems, that some ideas have been proposed, have been somehow borrowed or inspired by this supersymmetry approach and this games with supersymmetric sigma model. Now there is no supersymmetry, but at the end there will be some kind of sigma model describing fluctuations. And actually, what we at the end of this, not at the end of the study, but first starting purely theoretical work, we realized that could be quite relevant for description of high TC superconducting cuprates. And moreover, it turned out that just half a year maybe before our work, experiments have appeared in many experiments also in France that really are in accord to what we can expect, what we expect from our theory. So this led first to already almost immediate recognition by at least some major players in the field of superconductivity, although for me it was quite new field, and also conferences and some already maybe invited talks at the APS meeting. So therefore I dare to present this development in a series of lectures. First, I want to discuss what is criticality at all, what is quantum criticality, what has been believed about quantum criticality for several decades, and our results are somehow quite new in the sense that from the point of view of what one thought about quantum criticality. So now this is the first slide about what one knows about quantum criticality. This is the standard picture. So what is quantum criticality? We know that there can be phase transitions in the system, and usually one speaks about of phase transitions as a function of temperature. So therefore, for conventional phase transitions like in the Ising model or ferromagnets or superconductivity, one has a temperature and one goes in temperature, for example, up. So for down, for high temperatures, one doesn't have anything interesting, some dissolved phase. But crossing some critical temperature, one goes down and obtains some new state. This new state, in many cases, is characterized by broken symmetry. This broken symmetry, so one can visualize very easily some kind of ferromagnet or antiferromagnet. So one has completely disordered spins at high temperatures, but one goes lower and gets a long range order. This long range order means that for ferromagnets, one has just some ordered magnetic moment, and in that sense, the symmetry is broken, because above, you don't have any direction in the system. Below the transition, you have the direction characterized by the magnetic moment. So, and for antiferromagnet, one may have such an order, and so on. So this spontaneous broke, this is what is also called spontaneous breaking the symmetry, and in principle, the same words are used in high energy physics, and there is this phenomenon, spontaneous breaking of the symmetry. Actually, I think that all those theories and effects, ideas have been borrowed from condensed matter physics, because one speaks of breaking of the symmetry in condensed matter for really quite a long time. Ferromagnetism, then superconductivity, and superconductivity is a more complicated order, which is a pairing of two electrons, and two electrons form, usually they have, not usually, but in most cases they have spins up and down, and then these Cooper pairs are Bose particles, and these Bose particles can form condensate, superconducting condensate, and then in this superconducting condensate, one, this is the phenomenon of Bose condensation, and superconductivity is some kind of Bose condensation of Cooper pairs. So therefore, if one speaks in terms of this phase transitions, in many cases, and actually starting from Landau theory of phase transitions, one speaks of breaking of the symmetry, and this is, and the concept of the order parameter has been introduced by Landau, and this means that phase transition, that something singular has to happen in this phase transition point, and this something is formation of the order parameter. So phase transitions, it's not always so, but in many cases it is so. Now one speaks of topological phase transitions, and more complicated transitions, but what one what one discusses starting from Landau is the formation of the order parameter. So, for example, in this case, ferromagnet. In ferromagnet, you have some magnetic moment, and this magnetic moment is m is equal to zero for temperature higher than the transition temperature, and m is some finite vector for lower temperature. So therefore, this is clearly cannot be this cannot be just continuous transition. Just there something should happen. So one cannot say that that it is a crossover, that you come from disordered phase to the ordered phase in some very smooth way. It is not such smooth way, because the parameter порядка is order parameter is either zero or finite, and therefore something happens, something non-singular happens at the critical temperature. Actually, this is of course order parameter as a function of temperature is of course continuous, but at the same time some already derivatives of physical quantities like specific heat or other quantities are discontinuous. So second derivatives of the free energy are discontinuous. So this is general concept of phase transitions. And then one can start describing these phase transitions, and the beginning of such, okay, of course there are mean field theories of Curie-Weiss. This is the very beginning. Most general, it was Landau theory of phase transition and Landau theory. One assumes that the free energy one writes free energy functional, and this functional is something function, and this is something like tau m squared plus b half m squared squared, and tau is something like t minus tc divided by tc. And the recipe suggested by Landau was that you look for, you seek for the minimum of this functional, and the minimum is clear if you draw, f as functional modulus of m, you have such a function for t identity, or you have this function for t small identity. And then one can see that one has the only minimum for high temperatures, which is zero, and one has an additional lower minimum for temperatures below the critical one. And this is the phase transition. So one has to look for the minimum, and then one really can calculate everything, and one can study the transition, the properties of the transition. For example, one can see that m squared is proportional to c minus t divided by tc with some coefficient, and this is near the critical temperature. So, for example, near the critical temperature, the average magnetic moment is proportional to square root of tc minus t. So it is proportional to some power of Tc minus T, and this power is 1/2. So one writes in such cases that M is proportional to T tau 1/2. So this was theory of 30s, and then already additional information, additional knowledge has appeared already in 60s, I would say. When people realized that near the transition, the fluctuations are very strong. Here we write the free energy functional, and then with this free energy functional, one simply searches for minimum, and that's it. And here, what is assumed? A very strong assumption that free energy functional, so free function is just the function of a homogeneous magnetic moment. So in this theory, the magnetic moment is homogeneous. And then this is as simple as one can see, but already in the 60s, the knowledge has been evidence has been accumulated that this theory is not sufficient. And it is not sufficient because due to strong fluctuations that become so that all contributions of fluctuations diverge near the transition point, and then near this transition point one should do something better. And this something better changes all the critical behavior, and this critical behavior, so how to study. Then people really spent something like maybe 10 years and until scaling ideas appeared. And renormalization group ideas have appeared. So scaling ideas were developed. So strong fluctuations. And led to scaling ideas. Ideas and then renormalization group. So scaling ideas were done at the same time and independently by first Potashinsky Pokrovsky. And this renormalization group treatment is mostly due to Kenneth Prinsen. So, of course, I don't want to give all the theory developed about this critical phenomenon, how to calculate, how to write scaling, how to write renormalization group, and so on. Otherwise, 5 lectures won't be sufficient for this course. Therefore, I simply will give sketch the main ideas, the main knowledge, and the main belief about phase transitions. Of course, there are many different cases when this general scheme I speak of is not applicable, and one knows about topological transitions and so on. These are different stories. And also the aim of this lecture somehow to demonstrate that what we studied last year, it is also some different case which doesn't fit into the general knowledge accumulated for phase transition, quantum phase transitions. So therefore, something new going out of these general schemes is possible, but first one should figure out, describe what are some conventional understanding, conventional picture of the criticality, and therefore I go through all this history and assuming that there are young people in the audience, that maybe not everybody is familiar from these conventional theories, but if I go too slowly, please interrupt me and I will hurry up. So I shouldn't hurry up. Okay. So, therefore, the conventional story about phase transitions, so old story is Landau theory, just looking for the minimum. And I must say that this way of thinking about the phase transition so has been developed, has been adopted not only in condensed metaphysics, I guess it is quite standard, and there are mathematical theories of catastrophes and so on, and I guess also in France it was especially popular due to Thomas. And so, of course, such kind of theory is written in high energy physics and so on. Now, what is wrong and what one should do? In principle, what is wrong with this theory and what one should do? The point is that, as I have mentioned, there are fluctuations, and these fluctuations are not included in the Landau scheme. So, fluctuations by definition, what I call fluctuations, not only me, but generally what one thinks of, how one thinks of fluctuations. Here one searches for the minimum and finds a minimum. Fluctuations means that you don't have just the picture of just constant order parameter, for example, magnetic field. But in principle, there are fluctuations. Of course, there can be very strong fluctuations with flipping of the order parameter, but near the transition, slow fluctuations are most important. Slow means what? That instead of this ordered state, you have a little bit turned magnetic moments, a little bit. But on long range scale, this a little bit becomes extremely important, changing the critical behavior. So this theory, if one speaks in terms of on the language of high energy physics, these fluctuations lead to infrared divergences of different quantities calculated, infrared divergences of perturbation theory at the critical point. Ultraviolet divergences in condensed matter are not usually important, just because conventionally any solid state has a lattice, and all this interesting fluctuational phenomena, you don't have scales shorter than the lattice space. Therefore, everything which for short distances means simply that it is not interesting. Okay, people can calculate numerically the structure of atoms, people can calculate the structure of bands, this is not this business. So, therefore, how can one take into account those slow fluctuations? What is actually the partition function? Usually the partition function is the sum over configurations. And here one writes exponential, and here one writes some functional, and functional of the order parameters. Which means that one should write any such configuration with fluctuating magnetic moment, take this, calculate the free energy, writing some functional of this configuration, and then take the sum over all possible configurations, or in other words, one writes a functional integral, Fm, and here divided by t, and integral over all configurations. This is quite natural from the physical point of view, that you allow the order parameter fluctuate slowly, and then you take the sum over all overall configurations. This is in the conventional thing in the statistical physics, to take all configurations. And of course, the same is used in quantum field theory. You always calculate since his reformulation of quantum mechanics in terms of path integrals, then in high energy physics, quantum mechanics, one also uses now even more often functional integrals over all configurations instead of solving Schrodinger equation. Although both, of course, is used, but very often one comes to a similar problem of calculating functional integrals in quantum field theory. So, now the question, first question, what should be this F? What kind of F one should take in order to calculate this partition function? And second, how to calculate it? That's somehow the question. And it turns out that first question can be answered rather easily. What kind of this functional F to choose? Thank you. But the second question, how to calculate, is far from trivial. So, functional F. As we have written Landau expansion in terms of order in order parameter, what should be added? It's quite clear that the easiest way to proceed, let us assume that one has in addition to how to write it better. This is, let me write just components d dx m squared plus d dy m squared plus d m squared plus, here one writes a m squared plus d, and here squared and the integral over r. So a can be written as a t minus tc divided by tc. So a changes the sign near the phase transition. A small is just constant near the critical temperature. So these two terms are just the Landau expansion. This one is added, this additional term, and it characterizes changes of the energy due to fluctuations. So your magnetic moment changes in space, but it changes slowly, therefore, and this slow variations, slow fluctuations are naturally captured by writing the derivatives.
There's no time?
The moment I speak of classical systems, the time will appear a little bit later. Before speaking of quantum criticality, I would just want to give basic knowledge about classical criticality. So you are completely right that at low temperatures, at sufficiently low temperatures, there will be, of course, time-dependent fluctuations. And for statistical physics, time is somehow always imaginary time, which corresponds to Euclidean field theory. Okay, but I will talk about time a little bit later. So, in principle, one can write this just phenomenologically and say that now we should calculate here this function f, a functional f, with m where I in space. These gradients are added here, and one can study this. So now it's easier to write. One can do perturbation theory, of course. So this is theory, these are quadratic terms. And this is a quartic term. And the easiest what one can do is to make expansion in the quartic term. So, and here one can figure out almost immediately this problem about with divergent fluctuations. So first, we insert it here and calculate some physical quantities. For example, I don't know, for example, one can calculate the correlation function of magnetic moments, for example. And for example, this is m, 0, and here m, Mi, Mj, average. And average means that this is average of something this means that this is the integral of this something, and here minus f m divided by t d m f here minus m m t m. So one can calculate with this f, one can calculate this average, and this would be the knowledge about this correlation function k of r. So how can we tell whether we are in below the transition or above the transition? In order to answer this question, what should we know? What is the form of this correlation function, and how can one tell, looking at this correlation function, whether we have already ordered state or still we fluctuations are too strong and everything is destroyed? Actually, this is a simple feature of this correlation function. Correlation function goes to some m naught squared when r goes to infinity. This is ordered phase. This means that you calculate correlation of two magnetic moments at infinitely long distances and you still get a constant. This is just the picture that your magnetic moments, more or less, there is a component of the magnetic moments that in average does not decay. This is just constant. So this is long range order. And this long range order exists. And one says that one has, for example, ferromagnetism. Then there is another behavior is possible, which is exponential. Here, a distance divided by some critical radius. And this is this one. So this function decays exponentially at large distances, and therefore, in principle, one doesn't get any long-range order. So this means that if at some distances you still can see that there is something like ordering, so it is the situation when the distance is smaller than this critical radius. But if you look at larger distances, you see that in average everything is already such that you lose your order. So this is exponential. So this is qualitatively what one can get. And in principle, these two behaviors can be easily obtained. And they can be easily obtained just if t is much smaller than tc, or minimum of the functional. You understand quite well. So if temperatures are low, then this is just, this integral can be calculated using saddle point approximation. In this case, this integral is just exponential minus f at some f naught and f naught corresponds to zero. So therefore, we can trivially calculate everything if we are far below the transition. Then we just take the minimum. So we have just minimum of this functional. We calculate them not from the condition of the minimum. And we are done. So we get this ordered phase. When t is much larger than tc, then how can one come to this formula? The easiest way and the most natural way is just to neglect the interaction between fluctuations. This is t larger tc. How should one calculate this integral? So quartic term is neglected. And one calculates the integral for the partition function, just the integral minus, and here this, and I write here m squared integral plus a m squared dr t. So, and when one gets just quadratic form, this is Gaussian integral, then that's the only functional integral that can be calculated in arbitrary dimension exactly. And this integral can be calculated, and it is easily calculated, just making the Fourier transform and minus the integral c k squared n k squared plus a n k squared, and here sum over momenta, and here t, and in Fourier transform 1 d n k, one calculates immediately this Gaussian integral. So, and Gaussian integral is very popular thing, and Gaussian, one calls such integrals, so such exponential Gaussian integrals or Gaussian functions, before introducing Euros in Germany, even this function was represented in 10 mark note, but unfortunately with Euro this nice scientific significance of science has disappeared from these banknotes, and now this, they look much more boring, let's see. Anyway, this is the integral, which can be easily calculated, and this is just the product. I don't write coefficients here, but this will be product of t divided by c k squared plus k, and here, okay, 3/2. 3 is because m is 3 component vector. Assume 3 component vector. So, and one can do perturbation in m. And one can calculate, for example, the perturbation function. For example, m k squared is equal to C divided by C K squared plus A. And if you want to calculate the correlation function M R average, this is the sum over K exponential K R here divided by A. A plus C A squared, and this goes for large volume to the integral, and the integral dKr divided by C A squared plus A dK. And this is actually just like you cover potential, and this gives you A divided by C square root of pi divided by R, where D equals 3. So therefore, this exponential decay of the correlation function of magnetic moments can be obtained almost immediately, and one gets this exponential decay. And this exponential decay is for all dimensions, but the power of this R is so therefore, this limiting cases of the correlation function can be calculated almost immediately, but we can encounter a problem when we consider already fluctuations. Contribution of fluctuations, and contribution of fluctuations means adding this quartic term and calculating this quartic term using the perturbation theory. So still, I have not understood very well. So 1 hour means 45 minutes or 60 minutes. So just to estimate when I should make a break. Okay, maybe let us make a break now, just because what I have discussed yesterday is most simple things. What are correlation functions for some fluctuating system? And then what I will talk about next hour, that what happens if one takes fluctuations into account. Again, I don't want to give a general theory of detailed theory of phase transitions and all about this stuff. I simply sketch the main steps. And for classical systems, then we turn to quantum mechanical systems. And then at some point, I will talk about the case that we have studied last years that really is beyond of this common scheme of phase transitions, and there are natural reasons for that, but this will be later.